Johannesburg, South Africa, 1932. Caswell and Christina Makiba have a baby. They call her Miriam, or Zenzi. Caswell is a school teacher and Christina a domestic worker. They struggle to make ends meet, so Christina sells home-brewed beer on the side. Brewing beer is a traditional practice which African women pass down from generation to generation. But since colonization, white men made it illegal for Africans to drink beer and to brew it. Christina is arrested for brewing and selling beer, and is sent to prison with baby Miriam, only 18 days old. Little Miriam lives the first 6 months of her life in prison with her mother. Years later, her father dies and Miriam is sent away to live with her grandmother. Her family is made of music lovers and Miriam is taught traditional African music. She is exposed to jazz. She sings in church. 1949, she marries and has a daughter. A couple years later and she leaves her husband, escaping his physical abuse. She supports her daughter by doing domestic work and singing at weddings and funerals. Makiba and the Manhattan Brothers, a popular singing group, record the song Pata Pata, and her music career takes off. She makes solo records. She tours. Like so many other things at that time, the shows are segregated. She performs for the whites, then she performs for the blacks. This really strikes a nerve with her, and soon after she infuses anti-apartheid sentiment into her music.
The children shout from the streets as they see police cars coming to raid their homes for one thing or another. They say, "Kauleza mama," which simply means, "Hurry mama, please. Please don't let them catch you." Kauleza mama, kauleza mama, kauleza mama, kauleza mama, kauleza mama.
Filmmaker Lionel Rosen catches wind of Miriam. He produces the film Come Back Africa, and Miriam Makiba stars in it. It is an anti-apartheid film. She goes to Italy to accept an award for her performance. When she tries returning to her home country, she is denied entry. The government canceled her passport for her criticisms of them. Her records are banned in South Africa. Now in exile, she is unable to attend her mother's funeral. She meets singer Harry Belafonte in London, and they go to America together. She performs for President John F. Kennedy's birthday. Her spirit is untouched by the fame. She preserves her traditional African culture. 1966, she is the first South African to win a Grammy. 1967, Pata Pata is a global hit. She is prolific, having produced dozens of albums. She collaborates with Paul Simon. Miles Davis and Duke Ellington go to her concerts. Marlon Brando is a huge fan. She tours the world, and she brings her politics with her. She is vocal about the injustices that she's all too familiar with. She takes this to the United Nations.
"And all the leaders of the world, would you act differently? Would you keep silent and do nothing if you were in our place? Would you not resist if you were allowed no rights in your own country because the color of your skin is different to that of the rulers? And if you were punished for even asking for equality?"
Nelson Mandela, having just been released from prison and approaching his 70th birthday, convinces Miriam to return to South Africa. After 31 years away from home, becoming a cultural icon, she arrives to the warmest welcome. She becomes South Africa's goodwill ambassador to the United Nations. She receives honorary doctorates from the University of Cape Town, the University of Fort Hare, and Tunisia. She continues singing to the very end, her last performance only hours before her death. She is remembered through her music and her messages of love and peace. Miriam Zinzi Makiba, better known as Mama Africa.
Yeah.